You are listening to the Earplug Podcast Network.
Welcome everybody to the Today with DW, the pop culture edition, and please let's welcome, give a big round of applause for Lewis Perry. You've made it 2 weeks in a row, Lewis.
Kiss me, baby.
Hey, Brian, what's going on? Thank you for joining us.
You're not kissing me.
It is Friday. It is Friday, everyone. It is the pop culture edition. Lewis, how you been?
I'm doing good, brother.
Yeah, we don't talk as much as we used to throughout the week. We've been busy as hell, so this is kind of like just our phone call chat. What's going on?
Nothing. I'm doing those videos for ARE. You know, hey, what's going on, Brian? How you doing, brother? You know, all the flashback videos because, you know, all the cons are canceled because of COVID. So all those videos that you see popping up here and there with Gal Gadot. And of course, you got Jamie and I on stage with whether it be The Walking Dead or Danny Trejo. That's all coming from me. I'm busting my rear end for them. And oh, you know what? Here in my town, they reached out to me and they asked me about doing a little comic book art gallery. So I already have some people in mind that are already contacted me with talking to. So that might be something happening once COVID-19 gets under control, which will be like in 2 years from now. So Aviva, how you doing, darling? So yeah, that's something that I'm also working on.
Do we have a projected time frame? September?
No, because they just reached out to me last night.
Okay. Keep me in the loop if it's something feasible, we could come down and podcast right from there.
Yeah, that'd be great. Aviva, thank you. I'm glad you're enjoying those videos. Of course, still shots are up on our Instagram. And of course, you got the Faces and Heel podcast with Jack and I, Jamie and I on the phone. Plus, I'm doing the pirate thing, going to flea markets and tag sales. And
yeah, I'm jealous of your flea markets, man. I don't have them up here.
Dude, oh yeah, man,
you're finding some awesome stuff.
Yeah, I know. What's cool is they know me too. So you know what I found? Where is it?
Where's the love?
Dude, I found just last week.
You need to organize that layer because every time we come on, you're like, I found this thing, but I don't know where it is.
Okay. I got last week. Okay. The first Archangel.
Oh,
I paid a buck for it.
Yeah. Was that an X-Force?
X-Factor, what? 10?
Yeah. X-Factor 10. Yeah. What's going on, Ali?
Ali, brother, I got to call you.
Whole first line.
Yeah, I paid a buck for that. I paid when Angel, you know, he lost his wings in Thor, but you know the cover with him with the line through it.
Yeah.
Paid for that and the first full appearance of Apocalypse, all a buck a piece.
Oh, nice, nice. Obviously, nobody's doing their research when they're going to the flea markets. Hopefully,
no. I told Ali right away. Indoor flea markets. Indoor flea markets, Raquel.
Welcome.
That's where I hit him.
welcome Brian, welcome Ali, welcome Tracy, our other co-host, my co-host from The Mom Struggle Is Real has just popped on. She's doing well. New episode would launch later today, so that'll be fun.
Our family is growing.
Yes. The family is growing. The studio is growing. We got two more signed on in talks right now. Two more shows coming in to be recorded in the studio. If you noticed, I just got a new Zoom board. Thank you, Zoom Labs, for getting me.
Hey,
that
hand-me-downs. You got to send them down to the geek layer, man.
There's no hand-me-downs. I got to use them all. I got to use all of these things. You know? Yes, I will give you the hand-me-downs once I get.
You know, we've been planning on you coming to the geek layer, but it's like COVID screws everything up.
That's the punchline.
You know, I mean, Jamie and I haven't seen each other in like almost a year.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's got to be since Rhode Island. I mean, first my surgery, and then I still got her Christmas presents and birthday presents. I got to send them out.
Yeah, it would be Rhode Island the last time I saw her. So yeah, we'll all have to figure out, get together or something. Well, we know Eric, me and you were talking about coming up this way anyway. So once the studio's set up, we have to do that too. But
no, Rachel, they don't. Not in my area. Not the ones I go to. I mean, even Ali, who's jumping in and out. I'm drawing Eric Engel right now for a commission. Ali, you know, you saw what I saw, what I got. The ones I go to, they're very clean in my area here in New England.
Well, yeah, the cigarette smoke. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. No, I rebag everything anyway and chuck all of them.
Well, I'll give you a list of stuff to look for me anyway. But I definitely got to get down that way soon. So if we can get something going with that art gallery showing, that'd be pretty cool. Yep. And we'll broadcast that here. We'll put it on and promote it here, obviously through the network, whatnot. Let's get into some pop culture news now. Obviously, San Diego Comic-Con did their virtual con. Kind of disappointed in a way. We figured there'd be a lot of news coming out, and this year it was really not a lot. I listened to Fat Man Beyond, which I listen to every week with Mark Bernardin and Kevin Smith, and they did one last week, and literally the news was 20 minutes. I was like, shit, there was nothing good coming out. I was pretty disappointed as far as that was concerned. But again, it's COVID. They're trying new things. They're doing what they're going to have to do. I got to tell you, though, I don't see anything coming back until midsummer of next year at this point, just the way things are going. I mean, we're going to go through a really hard time through the winter. And I have a feeling nobody's going to be really comfortable enough to start it. And I think, too, and you and I have talked about this, too, you know, New York City Comic-Con, San Diego Comic-Con, they were all holding on right to the last minute to keep everything going. And then the cons that were still going, they were getting bashed. I want to know who's got a big enough balls next year to actually start promoting. And you got to be careful. I mean, people are going to be like, why are you doing this? You know, you're going to get the haters and the lovers, but that first con that's going to go put out and say, we're going to go, that could go very badly for them.
Unless there is a guaranteed vaccination cure, it's going to go bad. There's something's going to happen there.
I wouldn't want to be the first con to be like, okay, we're coming back for 2021. I'm like, nope, I'm not doing it.
Yeah. It's going to be something. I mean, I don't even think movies are going to be out the way they're saying. I mean, everything is being pulled. You know, well, Wonder Woman's supposed to be out in October. I guarantee it. That's going to be VOD. Same thing with Black Widow. Everything is being pulled.
Well, AMC just made a major deal with Paramount about releasing VODs, PVODs much sooner if they are open, because there are theaters open. Before you really have to wait 13 weeks for a major blockbuster. You remember back in the day when we had to wait for months for a movie to go out, either to be rented or bought. Now, within weeks, it seems the bigger the blockbuster. So let's use Avengers.
Yep.
Huge money. It wasn't even in 13 weeks. I think it even went out less to VOD and rentals. It went out quick. It seems bigger the blockbuster, the quicker they want to get it out in everybody's hands. If the movie doesn't make so much money, they'll wait the 13 weeks or beyond to even bother putting it out for pay-per-view or whatever.
So, well, I think The Avengers was still running in theaters and in dollar theaters.
Could have been.
And it was not VOD. Could have been. Raquel, for our events, Jamie and I, we get our hotel rooms paid for, and we have to book them ourselves, and then we get reimbursed, of course. I called up, and we already booked our rooms in advance, and I called up and canceled our room for Rhode Island, and they were like,
I think what she's saying though is that the hotels are very going to be limited on where people are coming from, and they're not going to rent con rooms, meaning the con visitors, because listen, we know Rhode Island. Let's use Rhode Island. I mean, it's our con family. We get people from everywhere. So all over the states. Well, so I could see that being an issue as well. I mean, again, if there's a vaccine, if COVID finally flattens out, I mean, right now, without getting into too political on this show, New York State's added, I think there's 23 surrounding states now that are not allowed to come into New York. So it's getting bigger and bigger every day. So
we're the same way in Mass. Right. Last Friday, Governor Baker, the governor here in Mass, he said last Friday, you can't, as of August 1st, you can't travel out of Mass. Yeah, $500 fine, all this stuff. I'm like, I freaking work in Connecticut. Do I got to get a letter from, I run a company. I'm the GM. How am I supposed to go to work? Yeah, I can work from home.
But you're an essential worker, I would assume. And so you probably.
Yeah, I am. I'm DOD, but I'm like, okay, so yeah, I work for a small family owned aerospace company, but what do I got to do? He changed things over the weekend. Oh, if you work in this, I'm like, great. Right. I got to write myself a letter. What is this, crazy?
We'll keep you all informed as the months go on with this show, with the Pop Culture Edition. Obviously.
Yeah, absolutely.
Also on the Angry Geek Show. We'll keep you all informed of what we're hearing and what we're finding out. Like I said, we don't like to get too political on this show, if at all. So let's get into some news. Since we were talking about Comic-Con news, seems more news has happened after San Diego Comic-Con. And Kevin Smith just announced, just last night, he is now making a Green Hornet TV show. The director is getting back in the world of heroes by developing a television series for a hero that still has great name recognition despite being unaffiliated with DC and Marvel. It's the Green Hornet. Kevin Smith has teamed up with Wild Brain, which produces kids entertainment, to make an animated series out of the Green Hornet. Deadline reports that the new series will follow the son of the original Green Hornet and the daughter of Kato as they fight crime in Century City in modern times under the parents' mantles. Now, Kevin's also stated too that he is going to be doing it's going to be a flashback stories. You're going to see the original Green Hornet and now the new Green Hornet going back and forth. And I think that's awesome. I mean, Kevin's already coming off of He-Man, Masters of the Universe. And from what we're hearing, that series is killer. It's funny with Kevin. Have you ever met Kevin?
No. No, he's the only one in the whole.
He's
the only one in the whole camp I haven't met. There's it's a sore spot. It does kind of tie into the exclusive thing that we'll talk about, you and I. Okay. It is a very, very sore spot. But Kevin is the only one in the whole camp that I haven't met. I'm tight with everybody else, as you know. Right. Kevin's the only one.
And Kevin. Kevin's
awesome. It's nothing against Kevin, the sore spot. It's
no.
You know where I'm going.
Yes, I do. I've met him a few times. He's awesome. And it's funny because if you're familiar with Kevin Smith, his humor, you don't think Kevin Smith and kids programming go hand in hand at all. So it's going to be interesting. We don't know where this is coming, where it's going to be. We know that the He-Man Master of the Universe is going to be on Netflix. There has not been an official release date that I've seen anywhere. I know there's going to be Kevin Smith humor in this. I'm wondering if it's going to be catered to our generation or younger. I'm wondering. I mean, it's not going to be heavy metal-ish, but I'm wondering if there's going to be some, over the head talk for the little kids that we're going to hear. We'll be able to catch some references that are kind of adultish. I'm not sure, but
I'm going to think it's our generation because it's Kevin. It's got to be our generation.
Yeah, I'm sure. Kevin put out a response saying it's an honor to escort the legendary Green Hornet and Kato into their very own animated series for the first time in the rich history of these iconic pop culture characters. We'll be telling the tale of two Hornets, past and future, that spans generations and draws inspiration from a lifetime spent watching classic cartoons and amazing animation like Batman, the animated series. Hell yeah.
Can I don't mean to interrupt you. But can I give a shout out really quick?
You can always wait for the shout outs after.
Well, I'm going to forget. Remember, I used to get hit in the head, and this is really important to me, bro.
Okay, you go ahead.
J-Bo McNeil, my brother. Happy anniversary. I want to say, is the anniversary was the other day for him and Ty. I want to say I love you both very much. Yesterday was their wedding anniversary, 4 years. I want to say happy anniversary. I love you both. And I want you to also tell mom I said hi, and I love her too. J-Bo's watching right now. I just want to say happy anniversary. I want to say it live on the air. Happy anniversary, bro. I love you. I love Ty.
There you go. Next time, wait, I'm done with my tweet.
Why, you want to forget? Go.
Well, so as he was saying, amazing animation like Batman, the animated series, Heavy Metal, and Super Friends. I can't believe Wild Brain gave me this job, and I can't thank them enough for the opportunity to extend my childhood a little longer. Now I'm assuming too, that him coming off a He-Man, Master of the Universe, obviously he's going to be a hot commodity now. I mean, he jokes he's fat and lazy. I got to say, I've never met a man who works harder than this guy. Mm-hmm. Totally. I mean, he definitely not fat and lazy. I mean, he's got a TV show on TBS going in the seventh week already. Obviously, he's doing multiple podcasts. He has now started a paid network as well. So you can kind of like a Patreon setup. I mean, he's working with Ralph Garman. He's doing movies. The man's got to be one of the busiest men in Hollywood at this moment. So lazy. So for anybody who thinks that smoking pot makes you tired, I guess it doesn't for Kevin Smith. I don't know. It's like, holy crap. And he loses weight. He doesn't even get the munchies. But I'm excited, too, for the He-Man. Masters of the Universe. There is no release date on this Green Hornet yet, so we will keep you up to date on further news with that, and obviously Kevin will as well. If you follow Kevin, he knows he doesn't keep his mouth shut. As long as it's not on CW DC poop. Okay, Ali, do we have a problem here with the CW and DC? Because I think me and Lewis might, we have you outnumbered right now. So you got something to say, please tell us what you think, because I love the CW, so we'll move on.
You know what? I think Green Hornet is going to be on Netflix. I'm going to call it right here.
You think so?
Because of He-Man, I'm going to think that because of what we're hearing about He-Man and Masters of the Universe, I'm thinking that Kevin has a good relationship with Netflix. I'm thinking, yeah. It's going to be on Netflix. Okay.
I'll go and I'll take my pick and I'll say, and we'll see what happens. I'm going to say Amazon Prime because there's been a lot of move on Amazon Prime right now too. And Kevin Smith has done stuff for Amazon Prime exclusively. So yeah. I'm going to put my hat in the ring and say Amazon Prime. Now, it's going to be a tough call. I think you probably are right on Netflix, but let's see what happens. Amazon Prime is making some moves. Okay. And some more streaming news. Today is a big day for Netflix because Umbrella Academy season 2 comes out today. Well, it's already out today. Not all fat people are lazy. I'm some. Ryan, listen, I'm not calling anybody out here. If you guys are listening to the audio version of this, it's because we're chatting with our Facebook Live family as they pop in. Yes, Netflix has been hot with its new series. They're crazy right now. So Netflix, obviously today is the season 2 release of The Umbrella Academy. I am a huge fan of the first season. I didn't even know about the comic book until I went into, wow, this is all Kevin Smith day. I went into the Secret Stash to talk with Mike Zaptic and Walt. And he turned me on to that graphic novel. And literally, within weeks, then the series, you know, the Netflix series came out. I got sucked right in. I don't know if you've ever read it, Lewis, but it's an awesome book. Awesome.
I got into the comic after I watched the show. So I was asked backwards too. Gotcha. You know, I watched the show and then it was like, oh, just like Lock and Key. I watched the show, then it was like, oh, I got to find these books.
Yeah, the Lock and Key was really good too. That's a sleeper lock too. It didn't seem to do a lot of advertising, but it did. But it was a good one.
Yeah.
So let me give you a little bit of background about Umbrella Academy. Obviously, it was written. I shouldn't say obviously. The series is based on a collection of comics and graphic novels created and written by My Chemical Romance lead singer Gerard Way. Now, it's based out 1989. 43 infants are inexplicably born at random, and then unconnected women who showed no signs of pregnancy the day before. Now, all these kids had powers, but this Figure Eight or the Umbrella Academy kept this group together. And if you watch last season, at the end, everything just blows up. Everything just is destroyed. And I'm going to give you an extended scene that just came out today for you guys to watch to get an idea of the first opening minutes of the Umbrella Academy. Let me just turn this off.
Get my popcorn.
Get your popcorn, everybody, because here is the extended first opening scenes of Umbrella Academy.
Luther! Diego!
Those are nukes, old timer.
What about my family?
You can't save them if you're dead.
What a hell of an opening scene. Holy crap. I watched it 3 times this morning while I was prepping for the show. I'm like, it's awesome. So you guys, sorry, Brian, if you are still finishing up season one.
Well, that's all we have for today. Spoilers. We'll see you guys next week.
Yeah, right. Getting back into the conversation. Ali says, I find CWDC stories boring. I think DW is right about Amazon Prime and Hornet. The Transformers on Netflix is awesome. I'm going to try and see if I can set up an interview with one of the writers. Awesome.
Yeah. Hurry up. You got to go.
I just started watching that Transformers series last night, and it was awesome. Really? The worst Cybertron was great. Obviously, the original voice actors are back for that series. I got to three episodes in. It was great. What is funny, no spoilers, it's a different take. If you guys watch it, you're wondering, it's like the origin of Bumblebee. It's weird. He's not an Autobot and he's not a Decepticon. He's in between. So it's a different take on what's going on with it. So it's pretty cool. J-Bo, yeah, I totally, holy shit is right. The trailer looks awesome. Or the first opening scenes look awesome. Now I have to get back watching. Yes, definitely getting back into watching. And we've been talking the last couple of weeks too, more streaming news. And it seems, Lewis and I, like you were saying earlier, movies, okay? The movie theater experience is definitely gonna change. It's even changed for me even before COVID. I've been very selective on spending $12 or $13, and depending on who's with me, and $55 just for a bag of popcorn to have an experience. And because they are waiting, they're coming out so much sooner that I don't mind. You know, I got a 65-inch TV. I'm fine in my house, the comfort of my couch. I can watch it there. Pants. But the other thing is Netflix, Amazon Prime, Hulu, they are jumping Disney even with their original programming, not going to the big screens. This could hurt movie theaters on top of the COVID situation. Why bother? So you buy a big TV once. So you spend $400, $500, $600. You don't have to worry about spending $12, $13 every time you want to watch a movie. So yeah, you might have to wait a few weeks. Big deal. I think that's the way it's going to happen. Seth, now my assistant producer, be careful what you're calling in shots as I'm calling you out right now. Go enjoy your vacation because you were supposed to be working. Who hires a man and then he leaves for vacation 2 weeks later?
Where is the boy?
Yes, where's the boy? He's not here today. He's on vacation. HBO Max 2, correct. Obviously, with their Green Lantern series coming out and what they're doing with DC. So, getting back into it now, we know Disney Plus. Yeah, I know. I see it. So, Disney Plus obviously owns Hulu, which obviously is part of Marvel. Back in early of spring of 2019, I want to say March or May, correct me if I'm wrong, there was rumors of a Hellstrom and a Ghost Rider series coming out. Now, the Ghost Rider series was going to be based off the Robbie Ray portrayal that we saw in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., which is the newest of the Ghost Riders, where he's a street racer in a car. It's not the demon that we know as Ghost Rider. It is actually a serial killer that takes over his body, as we see in the comic book. Or in the comic book that came out, that Johnny Blaze was still around. So you could see two Ghost Riders, which I think is awesome. Yes, I want Swamp Thing back as well. Even Shudder. Yes, Shudder has a good original series as well. So this time around, we've also have some more Ghost Rider news on the big screen. Ghost Rider is pretty much canceled on the small screen, obviously, because probably the deal with Disney and Marvel. He did get the Robbie Ray character, Ghost Rider, did get a lot of praise. The Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. episodes he was in were awesome. Probably some of the best, some of the best episodes Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. has had to date, I think. I mean, I'm a big Ghost Rider fan as well. So we are now going to be doing because Ghost Rider is canceled, Hulu now has decided. Now we've heard, like I said, Hellstrom, we haven't heard from since 2019 in spring. All of a sudden, just a couple days ago, Hulu puts out a trailer of Hellstrom, and it wasn't announced big, I guess. What, there wasn't a lot of lead up to this. I just happened to find it just by accident going through my Facebook feed. I'm like, there was no promotion for it. There was no real PR for it. And it didn't even come from San Diego Comic-Con, which was a big downer. You know, I just feel like the San Diego, again, I feel like San Diego.
Aviva says they had a panel.
I couldn't find it. I looked.
Yeah.
I couldn't find it anywhere. Aviva, yeah. If you saw it, send us a link because I couldn't find it anywhere. Because when I was doing the research on it, when this came out a couple of days ago, I couldn't find it anywhere. Now that could be either it's down or was part of a paid section. They did. And I watched it. Okay. Nice. Okay. Yeah. I can't find it anywhere, but I do have the Hulu trailer that I wanted to show you and give you a little bit of a background. You know what I think too, Lewis? And I think we talked about this on the Angry Geeks. I'm loving the fact that they're using some of the lesser known characters to bring to the small screen, because then you don't have to worry about people fanboying out and being jerks about everything. What do you think?
I totally agree. I seriously totally agree. I think that's why now Ali's gonna be like, but I think that's why Arrow was such a hit, because they
wasn't a big character.
Exactly. Same thing with Firestorm when they brought him in, and what they how they brought about Legends of Tomorrow. I think what Marvel's doing is now they're taking a little bit of DC's television, you know, because
I'll be the first to admit
DC's television is great. Their movies, I love the movies. It's flip flop. We had a whole conversation on Angry Geeks about this. So I think Marvel is like, let's take the lesser known characters, put them on TV. That way we could tweak them. Don't have to follow gospel.
Right.
The fair weather fans, excuse me, you know what I mean? Will like, oh my God, this is awesome. And let the fanboys, oh, hey, that's not right. It doesn't matter.
Right. Exactly.
I think it's perfect. It's a great, it's perfect chemistry.
Again, Marvel, and I hate saying this again, Marvel shows its dominance over entertainment. Minus the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., which the first season I thought was horrible. Yeah. The second season was mediocre. This season's great. I'm loving this season. Coulson, if you haven't watched, spoilers, Coulson is an LMD now. So they're doing it right. But them going, finally looking at DC going, DC's been owning the small screen since directed DVDs. Their animation has been killing for years. Their sales have been killing. Their cartoons have been killing. It's nice to finally see, like, all right, let's take a cue out of their book. Let's start doing some more of this stuff. The other thing is Marvel got the jump on horror, which I hate, because of Doctor Strange, his sequel is going to be horror based. So they're jumping on the horror genre. I really wish DC would, because I feel the DC universe's horror arena is much better.
Oh, it is by far. You know that everybody does. Well, Zatanna with Phantom Stranger,
Dr. Fate
with Dr. Fate. Well, Swampy, oh, we all know Swamp Thing just ruled.
So okay, their Supernatural is doing so much better. But I think with this introduction with Hellstrom, who we haven't seen for years, and he just came back shortly in 2019 for the Strike Force series, where he teamed up with Blade, Winter Soldier, and a couple other people. But you haven't seen him since the late 80s. He just disappeared. So bringing this particular character back is great. One, they could tie in the horror universe that they are doing with Doctor Strange. They may give us some teasers and open up that whole genre. Now we know horror is great. I'm not a huge horror fan, but horror is still huge. It's one of the biggest markets there are right now. Horror
and sci-fi. The guy who's named DW.
Yes, but because DW, you know what it means. That was not a horror. That was not a horror film.
Okay, whatever.
now I'm gonna leak out what DW means. But anyway, let's get into the Hellstrom trailer.
Yes, please, girl.
Unnatural behavior. I've never experienced anything like it.
There you have it. Nice little teaser. Creepy, goosebumpy. I got goosebumps in the during this trailer. I think it's pretty good. Lewis, you're still in awe.
Something happened to me when I watched that trailer. Something happened. I don't know what happened, but something happened. Oh my God. I shouldn't have said that word.
Nice. Nice. So obviously
that looks good, man. I can't wait.
That looks great. So obviously this is a lesser known character. I'm familiar with it just because of the 70s and because it's tie in with Ghost Rider, but to just give you guys a little bit of background. Now the show is based on the son and daughter. This is the woman you see in the prison or in the ward is their psychotic mother. She's a killer. That is not something that is done in the comic books. So that there's their twist now for the, as I hate saying this, fair weather fans, but for the general public. So basically the story of Hellstrom, to give you an idea of who this character is and how he came about, it's encouraged by the success of the titles Ghost Rider and The Tomb of Dracula, both of which starred occult characters. Stan Lee proposed a series starring Satan to be titled The Mark of Satan. Editor Roy Thomas had reservations about this idea and suggested a series focusing on the son of Satan instead would be better. Now, due to an oversight, now this is funny, the Mark of Satan is mentioned in a blurb in Ghost Rider number one, where Hellstrom made his first appearance. Now, Gary Fittage and Herb Trimpe were assigned, good friend, RIP Herb Trimpe, were assigned the task of designing the character. However, Herb has said in numerous accounts that he did not want to take credit for it, and he came in after that. So basically, the characters, Damien Hellstrom, first appeared in Ghost Rider number one in September of 1973. That was obviously spun off to a feature Son of Satan in Marvel Spotlight 12 through 24, also in 1973. During the Son of Satan run, Marvel Spotlight had a controversial series with numerous readers writing to object, of course, about depictions of Satanism and Wiccanism being inaccurate or furthering the cause of evil. Nonetheless, sales were strong, prompting Marvel to launch the character into its own series, Son of Satan, written by John Warner. The character's success faded soon after the series launch, and Son of Satan was canceled after issue 7. That's pretty much at the end of 1977, really where you saw this end of him. Now, I just mentioned earlier, in 2019, Marvel brought them back in a comic book called Strike Force, where he teams up with Blade, Angela, Winter Soldier, Spider-Woman, Wiccan, and Monica Rambeau. So this is pretty cool. His powers are pretty much based off Satan. I don't know if they're going to tackle Satan in this. I'm not sure how they're going to work this with the general public as far as I'm concerned. His powers are pretty much demon-like. He can raise the dead, fire. He has a staff. We'll see if that shows up in the series. You're thinking awful hard there, Lewis. What's up?
I was given a former employee of mine, of the company I work for, gave me some comics, some yep. Charlton, some Marvel, and they were look pretty ratty. And I took them, threw them in my desk because I don't like accepting gifts from employees. Threw them in my desk or in my bottom drawer of my desk. I think.
I'm going to shoot you, aren't I?
I think there's one or two Son of Satans in there.
Really? Come on. What?
I swear, if there is Monday morning, I will take a picture and send them to you. They're in. Yeah. Yeah, I think so.
I'm what the hell is. You just fall into this shit. I'm sorry. This is crap. I have to go move to where, man.
I think there's a Red Sonja. I'm trying to think. There's a Charlton comic. There's a Red Sonja. There is a Tomb of Dracula, but it's not the first appearance of Blade. It's not the first appearance of Blade. I
believe. Well, I'll drive to your house and I'll buy whatever. Yeah. I'll pay whatever you want for that.
And I think there's a Son of Satan. I gotta check Monday. If I didn't work 40 minutes away, I would.
Christmas is coming up. Lewis,
I can. Wink, wink.
Christmas is coming, Lewis. Son of Satan, I'll take it.
Oh, let me. Yeah, I'll give it to you, boss. Man, you know that.
Satan just spitting out kids all over the place. That's why he's Satan. That's why he's Satan.
He's like Conan.
This is I don't have a sound effect for the disgusting. Feel that I have that I have to announce that I have to bring this up, but I know some of our longtime fans, like Sean Murphy and obviously sadly Lewis, are a fan of this particular horror movie. So this has been reported a few times. Lewis had said he's heard this a while back, but it has finally been looks like it's been confirmed, like within just a couple of days.
What's that?
that Ryan Reynolds is reportedly in talks to make a cameo in the Snyder Cut of Justice League, and the cameo would see him reprise his role. Are you done? Are you done, Lewis? I'll turn your mic off. Reprising role as Green Lantern, as part he hasn't played since it's a part he hasn't played since 2011, and poorly received film of the same name. No kidding. At least that's according to Grace. So this is coming from an industry insider, Grace Randolph, through her Twitter. She says on her Twitter, she tweeted, "Now that I've heard it from a second source, it seems word is indeed getting out. So I can confirm the Snyder Cut cameo I've been teased is indeed Ryan Reynolds for Green Lantern. I'm hearing WB is working on the deal together to make it official." Now, I give this movie a lot of crap. I didn't enjoy it at all. You got a bad rap. It's because it's bad. I know there's people out there. It's a good popcorn movie, but I'm also a big Green Lantern fan, and I just didn't feel it represented him well. I know Hal Jordan is a comedic guy. I know he's witty. I don't know. It just didn't. I wish they picked a different story. I know you have to do an origin story, but I don't know. It just didn't do well. I'm hoping he can save face a little bit. Listen, enough time has passed for the film to be viewed with in the rest of this article, excuse me. Enough time has been passed for the film to be viewed with a good-natured embarrassment for all involved. The perception helped greatly by Reynolds continuing. Even he doesn't like the movie, lampooning in his Deadpool 2 and his Deadpool 2 movie. So, you know, even he knows it was crap. I hope they do bring him back. I know at the time of 2011, he had a 5-movie deal with Warner Brothers and a contract that they wouldn't let him out of. Now, we don't know if that's because it's if it was Green Lantern or if it was any superhero related type movies that he signed a deal with, and they wouldn't let him out of that. So maybe this is part of his contract. We'll see. Lewis?
Thought she was going in a whole other direction with that.
Oh. Wow, you surprised the hell out of me.
Why? Because I'm looking forward to him making
the yes! Oh my God.
Listen, he can't ruin a cameo can't ruin the whole cut. I mean, it's not the whole movie is that.
Oh my God.
You know, yeah. Throughout the years too, you know, and I've even said I've never been a huge Ryan Reynolds fan. I'm not blaming Ryan for the movie. It's a little bit of him and the writers, I think. I really think a different storyline would have made that movie so much better. I mean, even Sinestro was treated like a joke in a way. He's more powerful and more sinister in the comics. I just felt he wasn't represented as well either.
What they should have did, in my opinion, and we all know how I feel about the Green Lantern, they should have used the animated film First Flight.
I agree with you. Yes, I agree with you. I agree with you. And I agree with Rachel, too, because, yeah, he did get a damn hot wife.
Oh, yeah. we're going to have dueling sound effects. I feel they should have used First Flight for that movie. Yeah. Just like I said, we get to jump to Superman for a second. Man of Steel. I love Man of Steel, but I thought they used the wrong story. I always thought they should have used John Byrne's Man of Steel.
Oh my God. Storyline. Spot on.
Yeah.
Almost word for word. I mean, that whole script is right there. That, for me, is still the best Superman story I've ever read. John Byrne, I mean, obviously, I got onto him with you because of the X-Men. I mean, his drawing with him and Chris Claremont. But when he came on to Superman, like, I did not like the old Superman DC comics. I'm like, it's kind of boring. When he brought in and redid his powers too. I mean, all the other stuff became non-canon. You nailed it right on the nail head.
You wanted to introduce Batman to Superman. They did it perfectly. There you go.
Yes, totally. You could have done two different movies right out of that whole thing or one combined.
Here you go. That's what they should have did. So they could have started, because technically in that universe, Hal Jordan is the oldest out of all the heroes.
Yeah.
So it would have been perfect because you had Ryan's Lantern first, and then we had Henry Superman. It would have been perfect.
Yep,
okay. Would have been perfect. All they had to do was do first flight, then do Man of Steel. Or you could have kept them both that way and do Final Frontier for the Justice League movie. You would have been perfect.
The Final Frontier is a little bit of a stretch. If you guys are listening, we're talking about the animated features that DC does that kill, that are amazing. I think DC does better animated stories than they do live action, personally. All of the ones that we're talking about, Final Frontier and First Flight, amazing. Check them out. You can either buy them on DVD or they're probably on the Disney or on DC Universe.
Yes, they are.
Great. Like I said, I'd rather watch those than some of the live action stuff. And they could just adapt the animated right to the live action. We've already we think that might be happening with the Snyder cut because of the Apocalypse War that just came out.
Exactly. That was my prediction. What? 3, 4, 5 weeks ago.
Yeah. 3 or 4 weeks ago. I think we were both right on the money with that because everything was coming out. I watched the Apocalypse War. Then the announcement that the Snyder cut was coming. And then what he was saying was, oh, we're going to have more dark side. Here's some imagery. I'm like, holy shit. Not only was the nightmare, it's real in Apocalypse War, and he's extending on that. So that's going to be odd. Maybe they're starting to wisen up on their own too, and start realizing, let's do this.
Well, the only difference is going to be the main central character is not going to be there, which is Constantine.
Right, correct.
Because he's the one that says, you need to do this, mate. You know what you have to do. Not to give anything away.
Nope. It's funny you must have read my mind because we got a little bit of Constantine in the news. Obviously, Keanu Reeves, and we joked about this. I forgot if it was on this episode or on another Today with DW show. Keanu Reeves is going to be in every movie theater for the next 10 months with all the movies that he's got coming out. Bill and Ted, he's in talks with obviously with Constantine, and this announcement now is still just a rumor, but it's been coming from a source that has been correct on many fronts right now. So I wanted to do this. How long do you think the Snyder cut will be?
4 hours.
Three bathroom breaks.
3 hours. 4 hours. Three.
And two giant sodas. we reported on this. I believe it was even last week or the week before. Constantine is up in the air. Obviously, we have Matt Ryan, the small screen and animated version. Constantine, who kills it, who's spot on. But Constantine was brought onto the big screen and not in the DC universe. It was set on its own universe by Keanu Reeves. Now he is expressed, as we mentioned last week, that he wants to come back to that character, but nobody can find the exact rights of who owns this particular character. Now jumping backwards, Keanu Reeves had been tied right after John Wick, literally going to Marvel Studios, just like Vin Diesel did, said, listen, I want in on a Marvel movie. Now, at this time, it was the Eternals that were being announced. So they're thinking, all right, he's going to be an Eternal. Then a couple weeks later, all of a sudden, whether it was fan rumored or fan phase, it's Moon Knight. Now, I personally geeked out on this. Having him as Moon Knight, who's one of my closest, another closet character favorite of mine, would be killer. Put it on the small screen. You're going to put it on Disney Plus. You're not going to put it on Netflix. Don't put it on the big screen. And the other thing too, I feel, and I think you'll agree with me, Lewis, there's a big difference between the suits in the small screen and suits in the big screen. For some reason, the creators or whoever the headliners on the small screen have so much more creative control. The minute you go to the big screen, the suits just take all the power away from them. And we get crap movies. So this is why I'm saying I want to see if this is true. One of these, the Moon Knight isn't true anymore, but I want to see that on the small screen. So now jumping ahead, he has expressed on many different fronts of what characters he wants. Shut up. What are you talking about? What are you telling me to shut up for, Rachel? He has announced that he is in preliminary talks to talk Marvel Ghost Rider. Now, he is in talks, obviously, as Moon Knight would be. Oh, yes. Okay. Shut up in a good way. Yes, you're right. God damn it. Yes, it would be amazing. But I think more amazing would be this Ghost Rider. Mm-hmm. He already knows the supernatural. He has the action-packed, you know, athleticism to do it. He knows his characters. If one thing about Keanu is he researches the hell out of his characters. He did his research on Constantine. Granted, they didn't put him in the trench coat. Again, that's probably not his call. That's got to be a suit's call. You know what I'm saying? I think he'd be perfect for this. Now, as much as I expressed the small screen, what do you think now, Lewis? Should this be put on the big screen or the small screen? Now, Keanu's familiar with the small screen, and this, again, goes right back into our movie talk in the beginning. The movie arena is changing. Big names are going now. Look at Chris Hemsworth, one of the most watched Netflix series ever. And now you got Chris Evans and Gosling coming together with one of the biggest Netflix deals ever, and that's not on the big screen. Yep. So do you think you'd rather have it on Netflix or do you think, or on streaming service or on the big screen?
I would say the small screen, to be honest with you. Yeah, because I think because of COVID, I think the industry is changing.
Yeah.
The times are changing.
I mean, I think either I called it out first on one of my own shows or you called it out. We called it out that this was going to happen. This was even way before COVID. I want to say we were going into late 2018, early 2019, that either one of us called it first or we both called it at the same time, that the streaming services are making big moves and movie theaters are just going to be a dying breed. They're going to be like the drive-in theater. It's going to be a novelty that you go once a summer to or whatever. That's how I feel my driving theater is.
That's what it is. That they're making their money. So I am thinking,
that movie was awesome. I'm sorry, Aviva. I love that movie. I thought it was really good.
I think that because you gotta think about it this way too. Today, because of our industry,
Everybody's
a critic. Everybody's a homemade critic. Everyone now is an expert. Gone is the day of Siskel and Ebert. The day of Rex Reed.
It's gone. The internet.
Yeah. Gone is the day of Cybecker and look at the movies. Gone is that day. Now it's
we're also the product of that as well, though.
Oh, yeah. We are.
We are.
But it's like, you know, give a guy a rope, he becomes a cowboy. You know, that's what I'm saying. And so now it's word of mouth. They're the streaming services now. They're making money. I think they're making way more money than a movie that goes to the theater. You know what I mean? Yeah, the Avengers made $1 billion. Oh, yeah. Okay. How much did Netflix make last year when people that didn't even go see Avengers?
I mean, they're worth more than Disney. So let's.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying.
But again, one, putting in the factors. Granted, I forgot who it was. One of the Avengers, one of the Marvel movies has beat all records. It might even have been one of the Spider-Man movie. I can't remember off the top of my head. But you have to put in that, somebody wants to argue the fact, oh my God, no, the studio's made a lot of money. Remember the cost of the movie. Okay, that's one factor, is the cost. You had big names, you have to pay big actors and whatnot. The CGI, the biggest cost is the marketing. A good rule of thumb, whatever that movie costs, you double that, and that's what their marketing costs. So you take all that money and then pull out what they made in ticket sales or merch, and then you start to see their real price or the real value. When you're going into Netflix, yes, their production value is getting more and more and higher and higher. We see that, but it's not, I think you can put out a much better, just as good film with a lot less production value, or I should say production costs, into something like a streaming service movie. I mean, look at, let's use Stargirl, prime example. Now, they pulled it from their streaming service. They're going to put it solely on CW, which I'm not sure what's going on there. We've talked HBO to Max. DC Universe might be gone, might be staying. But look at that series. Compared to all the other CW series, their special effects and their action, I think, minus Arrow, is one of the, is some of the best TV that DC has put out so far. Mm-hmm. And that's coming on the small screen. The special effects are amazing, and there's a lot of them. And that was the one reason that Swamp Thing got canceled, because I think they went overboard with their production costs. And I know it was also location fees. Actually, it was more location fees and taxes and whatnot where they were filming that cost them. But they put a lot of money into Swampy. And yeah. I'll be honest, I never want to see the Swamp Thing on a big screen unless they do a big crossover universe type thing. Then yes, but bring him back and bring him on the small screen. I want Ghost Rider on the small screen as well. I think also with the creative control that they have and Keanu Reeves leading the charge, he's going to have even more control. And I think we're going to get something. Why not tie it in? Small screen horror universe. Let's see. Yep. Let's just rub away and get rid of what Nick Cage did to Ghost Rider, and just get rid of the green Ghost Rider or the white Ghost Rider, and just get rid of that. And something needs to wipe away all that crap. And let's get this right done. And why not? How about this, Lewis? Bring in Robbie Ray. He's already on the small screen. Now you could do two Ghost Riders. You know, I think it's a no-brainer. We'll keep you up to date more on that as well. I'm more stoked about him being Ghost Rider than Moon Knight. And that's saying a lot, because I love my Moon Knight. So we're in agreement on a lot of things today, Lewis. Something's going on.
Yeah, I know.
There's no anger today.
I was even talking about Marvel. Wow.
Well, you are a Marvel poser.
I call it as I see it.
That's all right. We're gonna end the show because we're noticing from our fans that are talking, they love us watching the trailers, us giving them the news, and this is kind of going to be like the new format for the show. We're going to end on something that I just found, and I don't know why I didn't see this earlier. It came out 2 weeks ago, and yet again, it is a Netflix. And I'm telling you what, Disney really should, the mouse should really start quaking, because Disney and Netflix is just taking over the world. It is the evil. Well, technically, yeah, it is the evil empire. If you really want to think about it, get the stormtrooper march, the death march out. Dun, 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 dun.
I don't have that. Do you?
I don't have it. I should. I'll get it though. I'll send it to you. Star Trek. But anyway, I found this morning. Again, it's Netflix, and it is superhero themed, starring Jamie Foxx. Now, we know Jamie Foxx was in talks to be in Spawn movie. That I haven't heard too much about. It's been quiet a little bit. I know McFarlane's got a documentary out, so they've been pushing that out. But I found this, and so we're going to get your popcorn, everybody, because we got another trailer to end the show with.
Power, speak a little loud.
If there was a pill, that could give you 5 minutes.
Spit it so they get it. I'm embedded with the power.
Of pure power.
I'm embedded with the power.
Would you take it? You don't know who I am. What I'm about, but I'll do anything to find that source.
Listen to my voice. Am I lying?
Welcome to Project Power. Our goal is simple: the next evolution of the human species.
You're taking one of those before. It can make you strong, make you invisible. You never know what your power is until you try it.
You push that power, don't you?
Yeah. On the streets, they're talking about superpowers, but they're not talking about...
Casey Neistat? What?
What's the plan now?
Took something from it. I gotta get it back.
Something? Or someone?
This thing's tearing our city apart. Your kid has something to do with it.
Where do you think they got the formula from? They have my daughter.
Maybe we can work together on this.
What do you need?
Still got the pills on?
It's about to get real noisy.
Oh.
So that's your power. First, we stabilize it, then we weaponize it.
Power goes to where it always goes, to the people that already have it.
They think they can just test their product on my city. We'll let them see what happens.
I thought we were like Batman and Robin.
You know, Batman and Robin, that's a movie. This is real life.
We doing this.
Come on, where my gun is.
We're gonna end this.
It's time to rise. It's time to rise.
You need anything else?
No, I'm fine.
Oh. Yes, you are.
August 14th. I can't wait. What do you think, Lewis?
I'll go read Dial H for Hero.
Well, you,
come on, that's all it is.
It's
that's all I, it is.
I knew we could not agree on something on everything today on today's show.
Seriously, you know that as well as I do. That's all that is Dial H for Hero.
Okay, it's not.
But I'll still watch it. I'll still like it, probably. I love the, hey, Batman and Robin. I love that line. It does look good. I loved Joseph Gordon-Levitt. I love it. I love Jamie Foxx. He's a tremendous actor. It does look exciting, but the whole time I'm thinking Dial H for Hero. You know?
So if that's the case, we're going to see some copyright infringement going on?
I don't know.
It's not tied to that book at all.
Yeah, I mean, I know.
I mean, as far as creatively, it's the same type of storyline, but creatively, there's no tie to that book whatsoever.
No. But it, I mean, it maybe it's just not many people probably know about Dial H for Hero. Mm-hmm. I know DC brought it back a couple times, but it's a golden age book, and they brought it back for the new 52 for about what, 3-4 issues. But it was a good book when you're 5 years old reading the comic. You know, you dial the phone, Dial H for Hero, and you don't know what power you're getting. You dial H, and the phone comes through. You get a superpower. You don't know what power you're getting.
So it's Dial H and Limitless come together.
Yeah, pretty much. Pretty much that's what it is. And, you know, you dial H, Limitless, and Hour Man put together.
There you go.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, so that's what it reminds me. I mean, I'm not saying, but what could you do in 5 minutes? Well, if you had to my wife, you know.
That's what you said. Oh, my God. Yeah. I can do a lot in 5 minutes. Obviously, you could see that somebody could do a lot in 5 minutes. My thing is I want to know the side effects. Obviously the pill lasts for five. If you take it, does it automatically? Now it looks like the watch. There's an opening scene with Love It where it shows him getting hit by the bullet. He's a cop. He lays on the ground. His power didn't take a full effect until he did something to his watch. So I'm wondering if there's a reaction where you have to hit the watch. Like you can take the pill anytime you want and then hit it. And then you got your 5 minutes. I'm wondering if that's the case, or I'm wondering if you have to put the pill in and then you only have 5 minutes left, like Hour Man does with his hourglass. The minute he turns it over, that's all he has is an hour. That's it.
I don't know. You know what? We're going to have to wait till August 14th.
I guess we are. Kind of reminds me of the comic storyline from The Boys. Take the stuff, get juiced. Yeah, it does actually. Yeah, you're right. It does. And The Boys season 2 is coming out too. I don't know the exact date, but
September.
They're coming out.
September.
So I knew we couldn't end the show without some type of disagreement. This is why we, Lewis and I, are here.
I'm not disagreeing. It looks good.
I know what you're saying. I know what you're saying. I know what you're saying. Everybody, thank you so much for joining us on the Friday Pop Culture Edition today with DUW. Lewis, tell everybody where they can find you besides on the Earplug Podcast Network.
Right here in the Geek Lair. You can find me every week on the Earplug Podcast Network, on the Angry Geek Show with that Wonder Woman, Jamie Dolan, and that other guy, Ali Montgomery, who is gracious enough to sit in with me every week. We got tons of guests, tons of fun and shenanigans, and you can find me every week with Ink Slinging Jack Purcell on the Faces and Heels podcast, where we bring you up to date on everything pro wrestling, from the independents to the WWE, AEW, NXT, and Impact. And every Friday right here with that cat, DW.
Right there.
Yeah.
With Lewis Perry. That's right.
I'm going to kiss me.
No, I'm not kissing you. It's okay. COVID. I'm not doing that. wait. What's going on, Tom? How are you doing, Wolfie? What's going on, Wolfie?
Don't call him late for dinner, but call him late for watching us.
Yeah, right. Well, anyway, thank you everybody for joining us. And like Lewis said, you can check out all these episodes over on the Earplug Podcast website, earplugpodcast.com, over on our Facebook page, Earplug Podcast. Also, start seeing some of our new podcasts being recorded in the studio over on our Facebook page at Earplug Podcast Studio. So we got a lot of things going on. I'm excited. I can't wait for hopefully. I feel we gave out more news than San Diego Comic-Con did. I'm calling it right now. At least I had more fun than trying to watch all the crap that was going on over there.
Wonder Joy Powers.
Right? Whoops, this way. There we go. Oop. There we go. All right. What am I? Am I the water or the I'll be the water in the form of water.
Sheep of a lion.
Yeah, right. Can I be the monkey? I'd rather be the monkey. He had more fun. Gleek. Anyway. As we wind down the show, we're trying to end the show. We keep going. This is what happens on every. All right, cut it out. Everybody, thank you so much for joining us on the Friday edition of Today with DW. Like I like to say all the time or after every show, stay safe, social distancing. Hope you guys have a great weekend. And I know I will see you next Wednesday.
This has been an Earplug Podcast presentation. Found on earplugpodcast.com, iTunes, SoundCloud, and wherever your favorite podcasts are found.